It's kind of ironic that I have picked a broken charger here in Launceston today to give you the summary of our charging costs and also the cables that and adapters that we used on our trip. It was pretty rare actually that we had any issues. We were turned away at one charger that was on private land, even though it was posted on PlugShare as available. In the Queensland charging video, I mentioned that we had some issues. Well, we didn't have any issues. We saw other people having issues along the Bruce Highway. But again, because on our trip, the nature of our trip, you know, we did the 43,000 kilometers in 18 months, meant that we weren't going fast at all. And that meant that we could take opportunities like slow granny charging at our accommodation, which really suited us. Now, there are others, obviously, who are trying to get to their destination and need more fast charging. We did do some fast charging on this trip, more on the East Coast. But yeah, mostly we did granny charges. So yeah, I'll show you a summary of what those costs look like. So this is a summary of the DC charging we did, and it's grouped by network. So what we've got here is the number of sessions per network, how much we spent on each network, and the average charge rate we got for all of the sessions. Noting that the charge rate doesn't show what the peaks are that you can get. This is just the average across the entire period of each charging session. So ChargeFox is up there, very pervasive network in Australia these days. So we did 38 sessions. And we spent $568 there, and you can see the charge rate. EV, less so where we were traveling, so six sessions there. The NRMA, we started off on the NRMA network, and at that time it was free, so we had three free sessions, and then two paid sessions more recently. The prototype NRMA charger we used in Ildunda was also free, so that was good. And then Tesla, so we use that more on the East Coast and some on the West Coast around Perth, so 16 sessions there. What I've highlighted there is that the average charge rate that we got from the Tesla network was the best at 69 kilowatt over the entire duration of all of our sessions. And you know, as we know, it is pretty reliable, so we really didn't have any issues there. I've also lumped these Australian EV Association crowdsource chargers that we used on the Nullarbor. They're an interesting beast. They're actually the slowest of the DC chargers we used, which maxed out at 22 kilowatt. So what they actually do is they use standard three-phase. It's available at typically roadhouses. And then because on three-phase, many cars are limited to 11 kilowatts AC, what they've done here is actually put in a unit to convert it to DC, and so even cars that have a limited AC charging can draw at a higher rate, which is 22 kilowatts, which is slow, but when you're in the on the Nullarbor, you know, it is the best that's available, so it's definitely worthwhile. So we've used four sessions there, and one was free. So across 69 DC sessions, we spent in total $1,128. I hope that you're enjoying the what's for me impromptu music accompaniment. I'm here at a park, yeah, just near the South Esk River, I guess, and yeah, somebody's set up a concert, which is pretty cool. So this slide covers the AC charging, and I've grouped that into the types of charging. So the first two lines, the 10 amp home and 15 amp campground, are what we typically call level one or granny charging. So this is your slowest type of charging. And what I've highlighted here is the 10 amp charging is where we really saved a lot of money on this trip. We did 51 sessions, but the vast majority of those were free, 42 of them. And that was because we essentially stayed at accommodation or campgrounds, where as part of the accommodation, the owner was happy for us to charge and not pass on the cost of that. We always asked. So I think if you're going to go to like an Airbnb, ahead of checking in, you know, ask if you can charge, say you're more than happy to pay, and that you know what you're doing. And often the owner would say, yep, you can charge for free. So that's how, you know, for the vast majority of our charging was 10 amp. And you can see we only spent $345 on that. Some campground charging where we paid, so there's four sessions there. And then I've got a lump here called wall and destination charges. So these are, you know, your AC chargers that you either might get in a home setup, so like a Tesla destination charger, or like the Fronius that we are taking on our trip. So for our car, these max out at 11 kilowatts. Some cars can draw up to 22 kilowatts AC. So those chargers, if they don't have a cable like the Tesla ones, then you have to bring your own Type 2 cable. So in total on our trip, we used those four times. Two of them were free for a total of $50. The final grouping is three phase. And this was important for us on our trip. And I think as charging networks roll out, this three phase charging is going to go the way of the dodo. But it was important for us. As you can see, we charged 26 times and six of those were free. So that ended up being $347. So for the three phase, we had to bring along the Fronius and a Type 2 cable for that type of charging. So in total for AC, we charged for 85 sessions for $817. So here's the summary for our trip for 43,000 kilometers. So in total spent $1,945 on charging. And as I covered in my previous video, for tires and glass, we spent $8,757. So that certainly made up for the cheap cost of charging. And then of course, all of the experiences. So they're, it's a classic line, isn't it? But it's still true. They were priceless. All right, it's time to show you our charging cable setup. So I'll take you around the back. So in a previous video, in fact, just after we had started the trip, I showed you the charging paraphernalia that we brought, and you can find the video linked up here somewhere. But here, what I want to do now is show you what we actually used of all of that kit we brought along. Right, so we've got, I've essentially ended up sorting the charging equipment into three bags. The main one that we use per the summary slide that I showed you is the Tesla Granny Charger. And it has the two 10 amp and 15 amp tails. So that was very important. Make sure you don't lose that one. The second bag had the Type 2 cable, which we used on destination chargers that didn't have a cable. So they were, you know, fairly common. And one of the most important pieces for us on our trip was the Fronius. So with the three phase, five pin, 32 amp plug on it. The Fronius doesn't come with a cable that attaches to the car, but our Type 2 cable would just do double duty. So it made this for this to be quite a compact unit. At the end of our trip, this, most people would have these just mounted on the wall. So there is a plate that sits on the back here, and you can just have this mounted in your garage or carport, and then use it as a AC charger at home. So that's kind of handy. And the other final piece that was used fair bit was the heavy duty 10 amp extension lead. Yeah, so just make sure that cable's really good quality and really thick, and so are the plug and socket. So this was a HPM one that I purchased from Bunnings. So we did use that occasionally. So that was pretty much it. So the fast DC charging, obviously it already has a cable built in, so you don't really have to bring anything along for fast DC. But that was pretty much it, what we used for AC charging, with one exception. When we when we were in Mala the first time, their three-phase setup was for a 20-amp plug, which I think I've got on here somewhere. So just a slightly different three-phase plug. But Mala is actually, the configuration there has changed. Per my recent South Australia anti-charging video, Mala is now an RAA setup, and the 32 amp is no longer available to clients. So the RAA setup is just AC 7 kilowatt. It's actually, it's slow. It's a bit of a regression, as I mentioned in my previous video. But it does mean that you only have to come along with your Type 2 cable and you can charge in Mala. So you don't need a 20 amp, five pin, three phase plug. But anyway, so all of these we did not use. So we've got a tail for the Tesla mobile charger, the granny charger. We didn't use it, but I brought along, because we already have the Fronius, which does, you know, 5-pin 32 amp. But I brought this along in case the Fronius broke or we lost it, at least we could still charge three-phase, but we never used this tail. Same with this tail, it's a 3-pin. I think this is also, this is 32 amp. This tail, never used it. And then the extension lead, and we never used that. So all in all, yeah, I think, you know, you can probably whittle down if you are doing a lap, either doing the coastal route or going through the middle up through the Alice Springs. You can get away without the extra cables that I showed in that third bag for sure, or plugs, I guess. And for some legs now, like the Nullarbor, you can probably get away with nothing. You could just use the fast DC charging. But if you are doing a slower trip or want a backup, I think you should definitely invest in a granny charger if your car doesn't have one, and also a Type 2 cable. I think with those two, you're covered. I think the three-phase setup with the Fronius is disappearing very fast here in Australia, which is a good thing. You know, it's kind of a hack. Yeah, so I think that that pretty much summarizes what we did use. I hope you found that video useful, and we will see you next year with new adventures. So stay safe out there. Cheers.